So yeah, I thought what we would talk about is of all things, war. You introduced me to really taking a closer look at the Bhagavad Gita, and I always thought it was like such an incredible paradox that this book that was Gandhi's favorite opens on the battlefield and counsels war. And I think a lot of times when people find themselves on this path to awakening beyond thought, mm-hmm. that there's an incredible sweetness, there's an incredible peace, and it's clear that that's all what we're gravitating towards. But we can, oftentimes I find myself in that peace for long periods of time, and as I was mentioning before, it feels eternal. And then, Shazam, some aspect of myself that I have not yet worked through, almost by definition engages in a massive sneak attack mm-hmm. on the peace that surpasses all understanding. Mm-hmm. And I'm in it, and I'm in something that feels very much like insanity. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's important to talk about that aspect of the path to awakening beyond thought, which is really gets you down in the foxhole sometimes. Mm-hmm. And I don't hear a lot of people talking about it. I hear people talking about sweetness and peace. And that is the destination. But there's also this aspect where what we're engaged in is a kind of guerrilla war with that aspect of ourselves, which doesn't want to stop thinking. Mm-hmm. Does that mesh with your own
that's
path?
Good. That's good. Yeah. There's several misconceptions, I think, about awakening in general. One we've talked about before, too, is that it is some kind of an Olympic gold medal, that you come to a point and you pass this thing and suddenly, Dominos Patres, you're done. It's over, completely finished. In fact, it goes on and goes on and goes on. One of the big misconceptions in the community is the fact that, you know, there is a point like that. In fact, it isn't the case. I mean, even after you've had long periods of great stillness, there's still stuff keeps being uncovered. We talked, I think, one time before about how it's like you keep lowering the water in the lake. And the lower and stiller the lake gets, the more quiet it gets, you see things poking up that hadn't been poked up before. And as far as a metaphor, we've looked at the brain, believing that what it's doing is its brain's very parsimonious. It likes to conserve real estate and conserve energy. So what happens then is, you know, it has found places that it's not using anymore. Big neural networks of clusters, sometimes emotionally encoded, that are very powerfully emotionally locked together. And as you've reported many times, when you go to those places and you do this surrender, let go, let go, let go, let go, there is this great release, this good feeling, almost a rush. It comes from this letting go of this very tightly encapsulated old memory or fear or old story. And it feels like dopamine. It feels like you're getting some kind of a hit from that release, which is kind of evolutionarily, Darwinianly, a good thing, because then it supports this cleaning out of this refuse or this conflicted parts of the old memories, of the 50 trillion synaptic interconnections we have that are clustered around, some of them not put in the best possible conditions anymore.
And then you get that dopamine, and you say, ah, phew, yeah, okay. Good job, you know, surrendering, and, you know, you let go for a while, and you're traveling along, life is but a dream, la, 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 you know, it's not quite like that, but right. There is this sense of increasing peace, increasing peace, mm-hmm. increasing peace. And it almost seems that as you go along, in true Darwinian fashion, that then the rocks that you hit are more and more jagged or sharp or somehow more primal, mm-hmm. and they throw you in a way that then requires different tactics, maybe. And that's what I think brings me to this idea of war, is that it's just, it's not so much that like, oh, I am engaged in a war with myself, or that there's some subject-object relationship where I am fighting against something else, because if so, yeah, then that war is going to continue forever, because if there's somebody there fighting, then you're going to have a problem. But almost by definition, when I hit these obstacles, it's a kind of sneak eruption of that part of my I that is more or less holding on for dear life. And it's learned how to either distract me from the tactics that have been working so far to even get me there, or that those tactics even somehow are somehow insufficient to it. It's probably the former rather than the latter. And it feels like war, and I think it's scary. And that's why I wanted to talk about it, because I think that a lot of times in my own experience, I've made certain amounts of progress, and then it's as if I'm totally lost. And all of this has been just a sham, that I've just been fooling myself that I'm healing and that I'm getting better in some way. And I just wanted to share that, you know, I think that that's part of the process, that you feel absolutely, totally, insanely lost. And that's when you surrender. And when you, if you can surrender when you're totally and utterly lost, then once again, you get that incredible release. And it's almost like the best joke in the world. Like, what was I doing falling for that one?
Yeah, I mean, the standard experience for almost anybody, this is you a long time ago perhaps, when they start meditation is that they say, oh my gosh, you know, this meditation's uncovered all kinds of bad stuff. I didn't have this bad stuff before. Now I'm meditating, and it's terrible. Meditation caused this bad stuff to happen. In fact, all you're doing is beginning to look at it. Instead of looking out here, you're looking back inside, and you find, oh my God, there's a mess there. And so you blame it on the meditation, when in fact it's just you weren't looking before. And as you were saying, as you get, you've gotten more and more still, you can actually feel the stillness get more locked down. It just feels getting deeper and more stable and deeper and deeper and deeper. And then something will come up.
And it also only has to be a ripple to feel like a mountain.
Oh, exactly. Because it is, it's good in some ways and difficult in others. The good ways is that because the platform gets to be so still and stable, it's an easy, it's a better place to see things from and to watch them. The downside is what you're saying is that, oh my goodness, it's been so still. Now this huge monster rock has come up.
And it's a pebble, right? You
whatever, it feels like a rock. It's like a boulder.
A stone.
Because it's been so still. Now there's boulders sitting there. And as you say, your approaches need to change. I mean, people say, well, can I just take this, who am I, and use that question forever? I said, well, no, because, you know, the ego is cunning. It's a very slippery and sly thing. And it will eventually find how to blunt and defeat this incursion, go back to your war metaphor, of this, you know, charging in this way. And so you need to come up with other vehicles, which is why, you know, we do a lot of work with, you know, where am I, or I'm not this body, or we do some chants like Devon Shadikam to try to give other ways around the defenses that the I has just come up with. And you have to keep, in some regards, go back to your war metaphor, tricking the eye, coming around in behind it some way it hasn't defended yet, and there's an opening there you can plunge through and make real progress. But if you just keep pounding along the same way, the eye will find a way to stop that. And so you need different approaches. And ultimately it comes down to what you say. You get in one of these fogs where you feel like, oh my gosh, I'm lost. All my practice has been for naught. I'm really back worse than I ever was. Is you just feel back into who it is that's going in there, and is it true? Is this absolutely the case? And then just surrender, just let go. And how do I feel when I have this feeling? Not good. So can I just let go?
And what's so amazing is when I've done that, you know, when I've after, you know, so at some point recovered and realized to turn around and look at who's having the experience and surrendered, is that in that experience, another tactic emerges. Like, I don't need to come up with the tactic. So, for example, what happened was is that that tactic of just turning around didn't seem to have kept the rocks at bay, as it were. Mm-hmm. And then I started to just automatically feel this kind of, that I was just a drop of water within the ocean. I just call mm-hmm. it to myself the kind of ocean of nectar. Mm-hmm. You know, that instead of saying, okay, who's having this? I just feel ocean of nectar. And in that moment of even, I don't have to do anything, that I just am that oneness, mm-hmm. which is, you know, strength itself. Like, right. You know, and so the war becomes, you kind of look up and you're like, oh, right. Okay, so this was just a war movie, mm-hmm. and I am the screen upon which the war movie is being screened. I'm not in this war. This is somebody else's war.
Right. Yeah, there's been this, we're always afraid to talk about grace. Mm. I mean, there is something ineffable that's running this show. This gets anthropomorphic, but we've talked about her as her. As a she who does this thing. But there is this grace, because you could just as easily, in fact, more easily, go into this space of fog and stay there forever. Mm-hmm. You could just maybe never come back out of it again. And yet somehow something happens. And you find yourself back in your good place again. And as you say, the right protocol somehow manifests something you didn't have thought of before, a whole new way, and the door opens. Another key goes into the lock. Another door opens, and you go through that door. So to me, this call whatever you want to, but this recognition that as you more deeply surrender, good Gita verse about this too, you're held. You're absolutely held. And we've talked about the fact that, for me, it was you let go a little bit, and you're held a little bit. You let go more, you're held more. You let go a lot, you find out you're completely held. And something, whatever you want to anthropomorphize it as, something takes over. She's been there all along, probably, but it takes over. And she keeps giving you new challenges. The challenges get, this particular class of problem, I've completely solved it.
Done it.
Yeah, and she'll come up with something that, well, okay, maybe not so much. Yeah. And she'll give you something that's just more difficult.
Right.
And it seems to be that's the game. It keeps getting more and more sophisticated. As you get more problems solved, she gives you harder and harder problems, like mm-hmm. graduate school. Mm-hmm. But you always also, at the same time, if you push into it, work with it, you'll come up with grace and a solution. And so to me, that process, you don't have to do after a certain point, do anything about it. I mean, it's just be present, be open, go towards things, try to let go of them, surrender, and you find out that grace happens. Grace does come in.
Yeah, it's beautiful because when you're describing that process, it might help remind all of us that, in fact, this place beyond thought is anything but uninteresting, right? Mm. It sounds like, oh, it's going to be totally dull. Selflessness is a drag. I won't want anything. But the exact opposite is the case, because all kinds of the intensity of experience actually ratchets up tremendously because of those iterating challenges mm-hmm. that are being raised as you go along, right. That it's the adventure itself. It's this cosmic adventure.
Yeah.
And I think that I'm just at the point where I keep forgetting that there's going to be more.
But that is a huge misconception. Yeah. The one I run into all the time. And just last weekend. People say, oh, well, you know, this is going to happen. You just become a robot and you just say in this darkness, this horrible, dry.
Yes.
I said, no, it isn't like that at all.
Yeah.
It isn't even close to that. It's completely, if it were that, we wouldn't be doing it.
Right.
We'd be doing something else.
Right.
We're not foolish. But it is better than anything else we could find, as we've done our study. There's really nothing else that's better than that. And if it weren't that way, we wouldn't be meditating. We wouldn't be doing anything except, you know, that.
Well, and the grace aspect means that actually, not only is there nothing better than this, mm-hmm. but that it gets better and better and better. Mm-hmm. And that even just a day or so after one of those big bubbles of insanity mm-hmm. that I went through, I can say, wow, thanks for that.
Yeah.
Because the other side of it
It's even better.
Oh, wow.
You thought it was as far as you could go before. Now it's even better.
Yeah, it's worth it, quote unquote, you know, if there's anybody there to make the calculation.
Yeah, yeah. And we've talked about kind of intensities of pleasure as far as you can subjectively describe them. And we did a little survey of some folks. And it turns out that it's actually more pleasurable, this non-dual state, than entheogenics, we call them now, psychedelics.
I prefer ecodelics.
Ecodelics, entheogenics, whatever word you want to use. But more pleasurable than that and more pleasurable than sex. I mean, if it weren't, as the Buddha has said, we wouldn't have any meditators.
Yeah.
If sex were better than anything else, that's all we would do. I mean, our culture gives us all kinds of messages, you know, 7:16 every day. This never stops about how wonderful sex is. Well, okay, that's wonderful. But in fact, there are things that are better than that. And if there weren't, then we wouldn't be doing them. Yeah, we wouldn't be doing them. But yet we find ourselves doing these other things. So, yeah, it is very pleasurable. It gets more and more so. And it gets so sweet, you can't imagine ever not having it.